The countdown, folks, is officially on for freedom in New South Wales today. 70% of the state is double vaxxed, meaning come Monday, families will be reunited and businesses reopened. Let's look at the numbers. 10.6 million jabs have been administered thanks to a massive effort from doctors, nurses and pharmacists on the front line. Well done. 60,596 COVID cases recorded in Sydney's third wave, along with 395 deaths.
Let's go live to today's Sydney reporter, Gabrielle Boyle, at Macquarie Fields. Gabby, breaking news this hour, the Premier is teasing changes to the Freedom Roadmap.
He certainly is, Ali. Our new Premier has made no secret of the fact that he's concentrating his efforts on our economy, on opening up businesses as quickly as possible and getting life back to normal as quickly as possible. And at this 9 a.m. press conference, he's expected to make small but significant changes to our roadmap out. Some of the areas he's likely to tweak the rules on, the caps on the number of people allowed into venues, mask wearing rules, and also dates potentially around when kids are heading back to school. So small changes, but significant changes as we move forward toward Freedom Day, which is now, as we know, October 11, next Monday. The Premier joined us on the show a short time ago.
We'll also be making an announcement for a number of changes to the roadmap, which will bring certain things forward and lift some caps on a range of things as we move through this difficult period of time.
Some very exciting things to look forward to as of next Monday. Hospitality reopening, retail reopening. You can have up to 5 people inside your house and an even bigger group can gather outdoors. Ali?
Thank you, Gabby.
Let's take a look at how the rest of the country is tracking in the vaccine rollout now. 80% of Australians have now received their first dose and nationally 58.4% are double dosed. Victoria is at 54.5%, jumping 1% in a single day. The state on track to reach the 70% reopening target in less than 3 weeks on October 26. You can almost see the finishing line, Victoria. South Australia sitting at 52.4%. Queensland and WA now so close to the halfway mark at 49.5%. Long way to go. Let's bring in our reporters for the latest developments. First to Christine Ahern at the Royal Children's Hospital in Melbourne. Chris, an infected parent has sent the cancer ward into lockdown. They're now waiting on further test results.
That's right, Carl. This affects those in the Kookaburra Cancer Ward here at the Royal Children's Hospital. Families there are doing it tough enough as it is, but now they've been told they need to isolate in their child's room here at the hospital for 14 days because it has now been declared a Tier 1 exposure site. This after a parent unknowingly brought COVID into the hospital. They were here for 3 days before testing positive. Contact tracing is now underway to see if any other young patient or their families have possibly also been exposed. The hospital also couldn't rule out the fact that there might be more exposure sites in the hospital in the coming days. Carl?
Chris, thank you.
A trial of at-home quarantine will soon get underway for 1,000 Queenslanders who've been stranded interstate in COVID hotspots. Let's go live to today's Jessica Millwood, who's at Brisbane Airport. Jess, how can people take part?
Ali, they need to be invited by the Queensland government. At the start, it will just be 1,000 Queenslanders trying to come home that will take part in this home quarantine trial. If it all goes well, it's hoped it's opened up to all Queenslanders by December, just in time for Christmas. There are strict regulations around it. These people need to come from certain LGAs in southeast Queensland, the big ones, Brisbane, Gold Coast, Ipswich, Logan and Moreton Bay. They need to be double vaccinated, agree to fly into Brisbane so they can't drive across the border. That is causing some alarm for people in northern New South Wales. They need to live in a standalone property, so not an apartment, have the check-in app and agree to be tested on days 1, 5 and 12 of their 14 days quarantine. As to when home quarantine could be opened up to everyone, no clear indication yet from the government because we know thousands of people are currently waiting on border exemptions to relocate to Queensland. They've been told that their applications still stand, but Ali, we know that there is a significant strain on our hotel quarantine system in Queensland at the moment.
That there is. Thanks, Jess.
New vaccination rules are in place this morning for truck drivers entering South Australia. Truckies from New South Wales, Victoria or the ACT must now show proof of having at least one dose of COVID vaccination. Starting next week, the new rules will also apply to other essential travellers, including emergency service workers. In breaking news this hour, France's ambassador to Australia will soon return to Canberra after being recalled last month in protest of the AUKUS alliance. That deal between Australia, the US and the UK put an end to the $90 billion submarine contract with France. Treasurer Josh Frydenberg will be joining us on the show in just a few moments. And the Queen was a picture of elegance today as she stepped out to meet members of the Royal Regiment of Canada. In her first appearance since returning from Balmoral, Her Majesty invited members to Windsor Castle in honour of the regiment's 150th anniversary.
Well, with New South Wales just days away from freedom, Victoria isn't too far off either. Premier Daniel Andrews is confident the state is on track to reopen later this month as planned, despite a big spike in case numbers recently. For more, we are joined by the chair of the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness, Professor Jane Holton in Canberra. Professor, really nice to see you this morning. Look, we heard yesterday 22 COVID-related deaths. And I think this is perhaps something we haven't quite reconciled yet with opening up. What kind of death rates might we see as things open up further?
So, morning, and let's be clear, death rates are directly related to the number of people who've been vaccinated. In other words, if you've been vaccinated, your chance of severe disease and death is really, really low. So it's really terribly sad that we've seen these deaths in the last few days. Interestingly, because Victoria actually had their outbreak a little bit further along with the rollout of vaccine in that state, we've seen a lower rate of deaths. So I'm hoping, to be honest with you, we see almost no deaths because so many people will have come forward to get their vaccine. But that's what will determine this as we get to that 70% rate. And of course, we're going to have closures of some services for a little while longer and then only access to those services by people who are fully vaccinated. That's going to help us.
Your problem is with opening up at 70%, as you know, we're talking about 70% of the population over the age of 16. That leaves a lot of people not vaccinated as people move around a lot more.
Yeah, that's true. But remembering that kids really do not tend to be as unwell, so that's important. And it does, however, mean that we have to be careful, particularly in these early stages. Really importantly, and I'm really delighted to say that if you look at the over 65s, and we know that older people are more vulnerable, we've got really high vaccination rates, particularly first dose in that group. Mm. We're looking at over 90%. And what do we know about once you've had one dose? You're likely to go and have that second dose. Mm. So I'm really pleased about how it's going. I think you've already talked this morning about we've got a couple of states who've got to catch up. So get out there, Queensland, get out there, WA. But I do think we're going to see deaths, we know that, but they should be lower, particularly the more careful we are as we open up and the more vaccine we get out there.
You know, we've been pretty mindful of Victoria this morning because I reckon for a lot of people still in lockdown, it's pretty hard to see New South Wales going, "You beauty, Freedom Day come Monday." How are you feeling about, because they're not far behind, Melbourne, they're not far behind.
No.
How do you feel about their roadmap out, considering where their case numbers are?
Look, I'm pretty confident about the roadmap, actually. And if you read it carefully, it says everything about that roadmap depends on health and hospital system capacity. So that's important. We need to be able to keep managing for people who are unwell, who end up in hospital. But exactly as is happening in New South Wales, what do we know we can do pretty safely? So to begin with, unless you're double vaxxed, you're not going to be able to go into a whole series of places. Mm. And that's the right thing because that's safest. And so that's what the Victorian roadmap does. It's what the New South Wales roadmap does. And indeed the ACT, which is right up behind New South Wales in terms of vaccine rates, it's there as well.
Yeah, I've got to tell you though, just looking at how the numbers, the vaccine rates have been going up over the past couple of weeks, it's at a very slow pace when you look at WA and Queensland for that fully vaccinated, isn't it?
Yeah, so both of those states are below 50% in terms of the double vax numbers. I think pleasingly, we're now seeing some things like pop-up clinics and pop-up information centres in shopping centres. We've got to really focus on people who are either thinking, oh, it's not my problem, they're a bit complacent, or they just haven't gotten round to it. Mm-hmm. And in those states, and let's be clear, and I think the Queensland Chief Health Officer has said really clearly, you know what, this virus is coming. So mm-hmm. please, Queensland and WA, go out and take the time now to get that vaccine in your arm.
Now, Jane, you've had a massive job over the past 19 months. I know you've now been asked to look at the quarantine program. What needs to change there as we open up? Because obviously 14 days isolation in a hotel is just not realistic moving forward.
No, that's exactly right. So I reviewed the quarantine system 12 months ago and basically made a series of recommendations about how to make it as effective as we could, because clearly our border was really important, keeping COVID out. That's not where we are now. So what we need to do is step down these quarantine arrangements, but to do it safely. We're trialling now home quarantine right across the country, actually, which is fantastic. You've had that report this morning about Queensland, particularly in the first instance for domestic arrivals, but that will then extend into international arrivals. We are also going to have these purpose-built centres. That's important. We need, if there are variants of concern, people who come into the country to be able to be quarantined securely in places that we know really work. But I'm hoping that by the beginning of next year, we're going to see increasing numbers of people coming and going, visiting family, friends, or doing things that they need to do for work, and being able to actually use their premises. Of course, to begin with, it's probably going to be standalone houses while we learn what works. But early next year, I don't know about you, I can't wait to get on a plane.
Oh, look, we're looking forward to too. I mean, Alan Joyce the other day, he wants to see quarantine abolished altogether for people coming in just very, very quickly. Do you think that'll happen early next year? No quarantine for international travellers?
I don't know if it'll be early next year. Let's see how these trials go, but it won't be long.